I never thought that I would have to appear a second time to address the same question with regard to another sitting president. I'm not a supporter of President Trump. I voted against him. President Trump will not be our last president, and what we leave in the wake of this scandal will shape our democracy for generations to come. I'm concerned about lowering impeachment standards to fit a paucity of evidence and an abundance of anger. I believe this impeachment not only fails to satisfy the standard of past impeachments, but would create a dangerous precedent for future impeachments. Impeachments, the American model was more limited, not only in its application to judicial and executive officials, but its grounds. In the end, various standards that had been used in the past were commonalities when you look at these past cases. All involved established crimes. This would be the first impeachment in history where there would be considerable debate, and in my view, not compelling evidence of the commission of. Second is the abbreviated period of this investigation, which is problematic and puzzling. This is a facially incomplete and inadequate record in order to impeach a president. My wife is mad. My kids are mad. Even my dog seems mad. That is why this is wrong. It's not wrong because President Trump is right. His call was anything but perfect. It's not wrong because the House has no legitimate reason to investigate the Ukrainian controversy. It's not wrong because we're in an election year. There is no good time for an impeachment. No, it's wrong because this is not how you impeach an American president. This case is not a case of the unknowable. It's a case of the peripheral. We have a record of conflicts, defenses that have not been fully considered, unsubpoenaed witness with material evidence. To impeach a president on this record would expose every future president to the same type of inchoate impeachment. It's appealing to listen to those saying, forget the definitions of crimes, just do it. If they do that, you can declare the definitions of crimes alleged are immaterial and just an exercise of politics, not the law. However, those legal definitions and standards, which I've addressed in my testimony, are the very thing that divide rage from reason. More responds, and when the last law is cut down and the devil turned around on you, where would you hide, Roper? However, before we cut down the tree so carefully planted by the framers, I hope you will consider what you will do when the wind blows again, perhaps for a Democratic president. Where will you stand then?
There's a couple of things I just wanted to highlight. I'm not going to take a great deal of time. I'd like to start with the issue of bribery. The statement has been made, not just by these witnesses, but Chairman Schiff and others, that this is a clear case of bribery. It's not. The bribery theory being put forward is as flawed in the 18th century as it is in this century. I would offer instead the words of the framers themselves. You see, in that exchange, they didn't just say bribery was too narrow. They actually gave an example of bribery. Because we don't want anything like what happened with Louis XIV and Charles II. The example he gave of bribery was accepting actual money as the head of state. Louis XIV gave Charles II a huge amount of money, as well as other benefits, including apparently a French mistress, in exchange for the secret treaty of Dover. But that wasn't some broad notion of bribery. It was actually quite narrow. So I don't think, if you take a look at the 21st century, bribery is well defined. And you shouldn't just take our word for it. You should look to how it's defined by the United States Supreme Court. This was a case where gifts were actually received. Benefits were actually extended. There was completion. This was not some hypothetical of a crime that was not fulfilled or an action that was not actually taken. The Supreme Court unanimously overturned that conviction, unanimously. And what they said was that you cannot take the bribery crime and use what they called a boundless interpretation. So what I would caution the committee is that these crimes have meaning. You can't accuse a president of bribery. And then when some of us note that the Supreme Court has rejected your type of boundless interpretation, say, well, it's just impeachment. We really don't have to prove the elements. That's a favorite mantra. Close enough is not good enough. If you're going to accuse a president of bribery, you need to make it stick, because you're trying to remove a duly elected president of the United States. Now, it's unfair to accuse someone of a crime, and when others say, well, those interpretations you're using to define the crime are not valid, and to say they don't have to be valid, because this is impeachment. That has not been the standard historically. My testimony lays out the criminal allegations in the previous impeachments. Those were not just proven crimes, they were accepted crimes. That is, even the Democrats on the Judiciary Committee agreed that Bill Clinton had committed perjury. That's on the record. And a federal judge later said it was perjury. In the case of Nixon, the crimes were established. No one seriously disagreed with those crimes. I would caution you not only about bribery, but also obstruction. Obstruction is a crime also with meaning. It has elements. It has controlling case authority. The record does not establish obstruction in this case, but impeachments have to be based on proof, not presumption. Fast is not good for impeachment. The obstruction issue is an example of this problem. And here's my concern. The theory being put forward is that President Trump obstructed Congress by not turning over material requested by the committee. President Trump has gone to Congress, to the courts. He's allowed to do that. We have three branches, not two. You're doing the same thing with Article 1. You're saying Article 1 gives us complete authority that when we demand information from another branch, it must be turned over or we'll impeach you in record time. Now, making that worse is that you have such a short investigation. It's a perfect storm. You set an incredibly short period, demand a huge amount of information, and when the president goes to court, you then impeach him. On obstruction, I would encourage you to think about this. In Nixon, it did go to the courts, and Nixon lost. And that was the reason Nixon resigned. If you impeach a president, if you make a high crime and misdemeanor out of going to the courts, it is an abuse of power. It's your abuse of power. You're doing precisely what you're criticizing the president for doing.
Is there a concern that if we just say that the facts don't matter, that we're also, as you've said, abusing our power as we go forward here and actually looking at what people would actually deem as an impeachable offense?
I think so. And part of the problem is that to bring a couple of these articles, you have to contradict the position of President Obama. President Obama withheld evidence from Congress in Fast and Furious, an investigation, a rather moronic program, that led to the death of a federal agent. President Obama gave a sweeping argument that he was not only not going to give evidence to this body, but that a court had absolutely no role in determining whether he could withhold the evidence. I've been friends with Bill Barr for a long time. We disagree on executive privilege. I'm a Madisonian scholar. I tend to favor Congress in disputes. And he is the inverse. His natural default is Article 2. My natural default is Article 1. But he actually has released more privileged information than any attorney general in my lifetime, including the Mueller report. These transcripts of these calls would be core executive privilege material. There's no question about that. Fast and narrow is not a good recipe for impeachment. Impeachments are like buildings. There's a ratio between your foundation and your height to support it. This is the narrowest impeachment in history.
Well, so they agreed to change their theory of the case to bribery. Does that not just feed into more of what you're saying about how we're actually, the crime matters and that facts do matter in a case like it, or at least should matter?
It does. There's a reason why every past impeachment has established crimes And it's obvious. It's not that you can't impeach on a non-crime. You can. In fact, non-crimes have been part of past impeachments. It's just that they've never gone up alone or primarily as the basis of impeachment. That's the problem here. If you prove a quid pro quo, that you might have an impeachable offense. But to go up only on a non-criminal case would be the first time in history. So why is that the case? The reason is that crimes have an established definition and case law. So there's a concrete, independent body of law that assures the public that this is not just political.
Guilt. Professor Turley, do you think Hamilton predicted a real danger here of hyper-partisan impeachments?
Well, certainly that has proven to be the case. Certainly of the two impeachments that we have seen. And indeed, when people talk about, you know, members of this committee acting like they want to kill each other, back then they were actually trying to kill each other. There's so much more rage than reason.